guest today who coming all the way from Las Vegas, Nevada. Everybody, put your hands together for Keith Rush. There they are. From sunny Las Vegas, Nevada.
From the sunniest.
Oh, Jesus Christ. I didn't do that right. Sorry. Oh, shit. Darren. Is it Darren or Darian? What do you guys call him?
I call him Darian.
Darian. Yeah. Darian. Yeah. I thought Darian was supposed to be on this call. Darian, you lied to me. Welcome in, Darian. Thank you for being here, my friend. Thank you for setting this up. I think I was looking back, and Darian, you set us up with Better Strangers. Is that their name? With what the fuck's his name? The drummer. Who's the famous drummer from Genesis? Do you guys know?
Phil Collins.
Yes, Phil Collins' son. I think Darian set us up with that one. Anyways, okay. You guys are like, great.
No, that's fire. Are you kidding me? I mean,
no.
That was a great connecting of the dots right there, man.
Because I thought I recognized his name, but when he sent me the initial email for you guys to come on, and then I was going through and I was looking, I just searched Darian and then it came up Better Strange. Anyways, that has nothing to do with what we're talking about today, but I just want to give love to Darian, the best damn podcast booker out there. Welcome guys. I appreciate it. How's Vegas right now? What's the weather like? Is it just hot, balls ass hot, or what's going on?
It's definitely getting there. Definitely getting there.
Yeah, I can't stand deserts. I don't like them, but I'm not the biggest fan of Las Vegas, although I do like the hip hop scene that goes on there, and I don't know if this is still the bunkhouse saloon, is that still going?
It's not. That is not any longer.
It's not going.
But that was one of our favorite places to play. It was a cool spot. It had a good scene going for quite a while.
Yeah.
But it seemed to change ownership a couple times over like a certain like 5-10 year span at the end there. And now I think it's just gated up, right?
Yeah, I think like the pandemic really hit that shit too as well.
Wow.
They're like revamping the whole downtown as well. So I'm sure that all played a part.
Mm.
That was definitely a safe place for a lot of Las Vegas musicians, though, for sure.
Yeah, great indie spot.
Yeah, I honestly, that place was really cool. I was in a hip hop band, and we got to play out there with a band called The Leak, which
is
no longer. I don't think they're any longer ever since Rasar left us. Departed from this plane of existence. Were you guys familiar with The Leak and Rasar and stuff?
Yeah, 100%. They were like the most prominent band out here, I want to say.
Hmm.
As far as like that went. Yeah. They were always booked. They were always on big events. They always dropped music like that. People were tuned in. So,
yeah.
Like the next big thing, the next, you know, something that's loud enough to get more attention than just local. You know?
Yeah. No, I mean, they were definitely an amazing band. And they came out to San Diego and played a couple shows with us, and I loved those guys, man. They were all real cool cats, and Rasar was real cool, man. It was really shocking when I found out that he had passed, and it was pretty sad. Yeah, I remember they were doing all kinds of cool stuff out there, man. So you guys have been around for a while, right? Am I right? Like at least 5-6 years, something like that.
Doing the So Indie thing, with Keep Records, it's been since 2012. So like we've been boasting the whole like decade celebration thing last year and all that. But now it's just back to business as usual. I mean, you try to find reasons to be loud and celebrate something, you know, like
yeah,
you know, just to make a little more noise, because otherwise it's just same people doing the same shit. Like no, we try to We try to make sure there's something new, something fresh.
Yeah, I would do that on the podcast. Be like, on this very special episode. It's like, yeah. It's just like every other fucking episode. It's just, I said it was special.
Exactly.
Or I mean, you know, I mean, 10 years, though. 10 years is a long time to be a collective of musicians, especially rappers. You know, nothing against rappers. I love hip hop. I love rap, all that kind of stuff. But, you know, there tends to be a little bit of ego involved. And I think that it's sort of celebrated, in fact, within the culture. How did you guys manage to not hate each other after 10 years?
Well, I think as far as like the whole story goes, like, you know, the whole Keep Records thing started. Maybe like a couple of us weren't so involved right then. We kind of all gradually have, like, in a couple years, been added in, or like, you know, added on projects and shit. So it's not really like we've all been together for 10 years, but, I mean, it's easy because these types of people are like, just people that understand the art that we're all trying to create. So it's really not so much ego going on. It's more like, okay, well, how can we just keep creating cool shit together?
Kind of team up, you know? It's like a full on creative freedom. Each artist is their own individual artist, but it's like, you know, the strength in numbers. If we pool our resources and do one big thing, we can make a little more noise together and have fun while we're doing it. You know, that kind of shit.
Yeah, hell yeah, man. So it's not like you guys are like constantly in the same room with each other trying to work things out. You guys sort of work separately and then get together and do stuff.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So what was the concept behind it then? Like, what was the idea about starting a collective like you guys are a part of? And who started it? Who are we blaming?
You can blame me for all that shit. I blame myself too, man.
By the way, can you guys introduce yourselves so people know who you guys are?
So I'm Chief DVB.
There you go.
And I'm Syntax Vernac.
There you go.
Syntax Vernac is basically the brain behind Keep Records.
That just means I'm the guy that like pays the tax bill when it comes each year and have to make sure like the business license is up to date and all that bullshit.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you know what it is. I'm sure you deal with a lot of the same stuff.
I know exactly what it is, man. I know exactly what it is. And I mean, it looks like you guys have had a busy, you know, decade. You guys have been to Europe and shit, like Australia. Yeah. Like,
yeah,
that's wild. Well, let's just start from why did you start such a thing, Syntax? Why did you start Keep Records?
Well, it was mainly because at the time I was in a group that was trying to like shop our album to get picked up by, let's say, like a larger label or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just like either non-answers or declining from places that we thought were like perfect fits and yada yada. You knock on enough doors, you get enough people saying no, you're just like, well, then how can we go about doing this ourselves? And you know, thank goodness it's gotten to the point in the industry where people can just go and do what they want much easier now, but for us it was more like trying to figure shit out, you know, pressing one project at a time. You know, but that's it, man. It was just like, if no one's going to get behind us and we can tell that, then let's do as much as we can by ourselves until the point that others come to us for work at that point. Cause we knew we weren't the only ones, you know, there's that whole sea of independent artists that like sell just between like 500 and 1,000 titles of a record. Like they're never quite popping enough to like do it for a living type of shit. But like when, you know, maybe half the year when they're touring, they could do it, but they got to come home and get a regular job. Like, you know, there's a whole world of those artists. And we kind of just decided if we can all put our half time into one bucket and pool our resources, we can be just that much stronger together and everyone benefit from that, rather than everyone just trying to fucking claw at the same little puddle that's not going to fucking satisfy anybody anyway.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. So were you guys able to attain that? Were you guys able to do that? Or is this all you guys do is just do Keep Records and So Indie projects and stuff?
Unfortunately not. No, it's still very much like we're the working class rhymers, you know? As far as I understand, everybody that we work with are also people that have incomes that are not solely this. Now, some of them are like engineers, you know, like Chief, for instance, he's always around music. His income is fully through music,
but
it's not like solely through rapping, you know, it's by wearing many hats and doing a lot of different things for a lot of different people, you know.
What kind of hats you wear, Chief?
So basically, like, what I realized, because I was also in a rap group early on, and so my homie was a producer, I was the rapper, my friend was the graphic artist, and, like, at some point, we had to figure out, like, everyone had to have their own extra kind of thing for it. So, like, the engineering thing kind of came in to my realm of things. So I started doing that because, like, even if I'm not writing on a record or something like that, like, I'd still like to be a part of, like, just the creation of records in general. So I think, like, I get that off in engineering. And it's also, like, you know, another freelance thing that I can make income on, but also be a part of music at the same time instead of, like, just completely, you know, take the rest off or whatever. So,
yeah. So you do engineering, mixing and mastering, stuff like that?
Mm-hmm.
And then do you do production as well?
Sometimes, not as often as the engineering side, but, yeah, I've done a couple production things here and there. Not more focused on that, but it's definitely come up for sure.
Do you also do, like, graphic design and stuff like that?
Not really. So mostly what I've been doing for the most part is actually recording a lot. So I've helped, like, you know, recording with this R&B artist that I'm working with, or like I just helped record the Pauly Shore cover album that came out, or like, you know, just a bunch of random recordings in general. So that's kind of been my main thing.
That's dope. That's dope. Yeah, I mean, to be able to be a full-time rapper without, like, you know, without like a day job or whatever, it's very difficult. I do feel for rappers, because it's like, it's a very specific thing, right? And if you're not getting paid for your verses, you know, just to spit on someone's album, or, you know, you're not making money off of your streams or whatever it is, it's very difficult to make money as a rapper. I know exactly what that is, where you have to sort of take on a lot of different things to make ends meet. It's like, I can't just be a podcaster. It's like, I also do mixing, mastering, I also play music and play out and do tons of different things. And I feel like when people get into this, they don't necessarily understand that aspect of it. They're just like, I'm gonna be a rapper, that's it, I'm ready to go, you know.
Yeah.
Here I am, world, pay me. And then, you know, the reality is like, well, you gotta make content too, and you gotta, like, there's visuals, and it's not just music and bars. It's like fucking, you know, it's a whole thing. Producers and photographers and videographers and the whole fucking thing. It's
everything else under the sun, right?
It's an expensive bit of being an artist, but if you can figure out different ways of, you know, like taking on the graphic design or taking on the videography and stuff. Or even the engineering stuff, you can make things work, but man, it is fucking hard. When you guys are how did you guys? I'm just amazed that you guys were able to go to Europe and, like, Australia. How did you guys end up going all the way across the pond there?
It's gonna sound like this. I don't mean it to sound like a dick answer, but it's like, you come up with an idea and then you fucking make it happen.
You execute.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Because like when we say so indie, it hurts. Like, it's really indie.
It really
like,
hurts.
It's really too. Us, and it really hurts. It really because hurts. We have to come out the pocket for that shit.
Yeah.
Or, you know, we have to be gone away from home for, in his case, it was 2 weeks. In my case, it was 2 months.
Wow.
Like we're out there, you know, making contacts with record stores, walking into distributors, and actually showing that, like, we're willing to meet people halfway. We're willing to put in that effort. Mm. We're, you know, hitting it from all sides because we don't have the
machine.
Yeah, the machine. We don't have agents booking shit for us. We don't have, you know, if we do ever get publicity or whatnot, it's because we're paying for it during very specific times to do very specific campaigns. Like, there's no big money machine behind us. There's no, like, when we say so indie it hurts, we mean it. But that means also, if we want to go to Australia next month, we're going to find out how, just like how you and your homies would decide you're going to go to Australia together and do something.
Hmm.
Even if it wasn't music related, right? There's a certain amount of planning that goes in with that. Yeah. So, like, it's damn near the same thing as just calling some friends and being like, hey, let's go on a trip together. But instead of booking, you know, reservations for where you're going to have dinner, we're booking venues to do shows, or we're booking meetings with owners of record stores to try to see about getting in there, that right. kind of shit, you know?
Yeah.
But otherwise, it's like, that's why we go to these locations that sound so cool when you say it out loud, because like, that's where we wanted to go anyway. And if we got to pay for the shit ourselves, we better just go to the places we want to be, you know?
Yeah, that's how I kind of looked at it too, man. Touring and stuff. I always looked at it as just like going and hanging out with the homies. Until it started making money, and then it was like, oh, that's fun. That this is a bonus. Like, you get,
yeah,
I get to bring home money. Well, that's a bonus, baby. Yeah, make it happen. The going on tour thing is really fun, but it's stressful, man. It's stressful. Did you guys have you guys ran any problems on the road? Have you guys had like any breakdowns or anything? Any car breakdowns? Anything horrendous go down?
Breakdowns or shit like that, not in particular, because for the most part we try to stay on top of things like that that we know like are classic things that happen like that. But in particular, now that you're saying that, on our first tour we went on, we had like whatever 12 guys with us, and I remember one of my friends got a little too faded, or maybe he didn't wake up quick enough. And, like, we were all tripping. We're like, yo, is he good? Like, oh, man, like, this is a whole different area of things going on. He ended up being good or whatever. But, like, it's little things like that where we're like, oh, shit, man. Like, if people get hurt out here, we're, like,
with each other. Yo, is Timmy dead, bro? Is Timmy fucking...
If we don't make it somewhere, we're responsible for each other. If we don't do this, it's, like, it's really a group and team effort, which comes into play a lot on that,
which is why we shrank the number down a little bit.
Yeah,
since that tour we used to go out two vans packed, you know, six heads, team A, team B, let's hit these fucking streets.
Yeah.
And now we've kind of narrowed it down. Like, we try to keep it six heads, maybe eight heads, but when you start getting into the 12 or more people on the road, it starts becoming a chore just to go get a fucking cup of coffee in the morning, you know? Yeah. And you know I'm right. You know I'm right.
I don't.
Yeah, like all that shit. It's like,
now imagine booking dinner, booking a show, booking an interview, making sure everyone has to be at the same place, like well-fed, someone's not too hungover to talk.
Yeah.
Or, you know what I mean? Man, all those little things.
Everything in between.
Oh, dude, you're giving me fucking, you're bringing back the trauma. You're bringing back, I'm getting triggered, bro. I'm getting triggered right now. No, the, oh God, I, yeah, just when you said getting coffee is a chore, like, it just, that triggered so many just memories, just and like angry blowouts at each other just be over something stupid like coffee, you know, just like, well, fuck you. It's like, oh man, it's not like that. It's not that serious, but but it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
what made you guys shrink down?
Not so much shrink down like as an overall collective, mm-hmm. because the collective is bigger and stronger now than it's ever been, thank goodness. You know, but I just mean now when we do these So Indie tours, mm-hmm. when we do these trips, that it's more like that. Like now we just do the tours more often, but they're more streamlined. It's like, mm-hmm. we come in there with a scalpel, man. We get exactly what we need. We get in, we get the fuck out of there. When it's when it's, you know, 14, 15, 16 people on the mission, it's not so much the scalpel thing. Now it's like, okay, we have to go back, double check some shit, triple check some shit. Mm. You can't, we seem to get more done with a smaller squad when we're on the road. So we just go on the road more often with smaller squads each time.
And also too, cause like people can't, like all those people can't do that every single time that we figure out we're going to do that or something too. So it's like, you know, that's another thing is availability. Like people can't just, well, people have to, couple months or whatever.
Yeah, people have lives and stuff that can't just be disrupted at a moment's notice. The whole idea of going out with a smaller crew, that is like such a crucial point to make. Like I still tour with these guys once in a while, but it was a reggae band, and I don't know if you guys know anything about reggae bands, but they can be from like three people to like 50 motherfuckers on stage. It's kind of like hip hop in that sense, where like everybody's on stage, everybody's got a microphone, and everybody wants to be heard. So it is that it's that whole thing, man. I remember we played this reggae festival called Cali Roots up in Monterey, and you know, nobody, you know, like sometimes it's like pulling teeth trying to get people to go on the road. As soon as we said we're playing this festival, which is a very popular reggae festival, especially for California,
the band went from 10 people to 23 people. Yeah,
of course.
Yeah, and everybody's like, oh, we got can I bring my girl with me? Like, everybody's. It was such a shit show. We had three hand percussionists, and like I'm just like, can we get horn players or something? Like, we don't need three fucking hand percussionists. It was ridiculous, but you know, we have a good time. We had a good time. But yeah, cutting down on the road, if you don't need that many people on the road, it's just better to just be able to be a nice compact. If you can take your crew in a fucking like Hyundai Sonata to the gig, you know what I mean? Like that, you're winning. You're fucking winning. It's like the DJ put his shit in the back, or better yet, they got a deck at the fucking club. Let's just fucking jump in this little ass car and go. Oh my God. Anyway.
Yeah, or if you got 12 people, dude, and rather than go on the one tour, you send half the squad to the Northwest, and you send squad A to the Northwest, squad B to like New England, and boom, your squad is technically on tour in two different regions at the, during the same week, representing the You know what I mean? I mean, it's just the strength in numbers. It's like a big old. That old board game Risk or whatever, you're just looking at the board trying to put your pieces in the spots that you like to be at, you know.
Hell yeah, let's go. That's actually brilliant. This fucking, everybody keep that in mind, up and coming musicians, send half the squad to the east.
For real, that's
half the squad to the west.
Crazy.
You get
it for half off.
There you go. Have you guys ever done that before? Like, send squad A over here, send squad B over here.
Yeah, I've been on tour in Hawaii while I had another crew that was on tour in where was it? Like Bakersfield or some shit. Like somewhere on their way up to where the next stop was going to be San Francisco.
Yeah.
So we had it scheduled to where like I was flying in from Honolulu into Long Beach, which just so happened to be between Bakersfield and San Francisco. So I landed, I hopped in the whip, and we kept on, and I joined them at the San Francisco stop. So it, you know, it's fucked up. It's weird, but
hey,
I mean, the shit we do, you know,
for the love of music, man, it's wild. Yeah. It's wild. It's sleeping on nasty ass floors, some stranger's house. Just save some money. Oh my god, dude, that shit sucked though. I remember we were supposed to stay the night at these people's house, and it was like the whole floor was like completely wet, like the carpet was all wet, it was raining, and then they had dogs, and people were just like, and the dogs just shit everywhere, like, and like we were supposed to sleep on this wet fucking cold floor. With dogs and shit. Like, No. Me and the drummer, we were like, no, fuck this. We're gonna spend our money on a hotel. I don't care if we don't eat tomorrow. We're fucking spending money on a hotel, because I'd rather.
At some point, you have to set that standard.
That's the
thing. Level.
Yeah, that's the like sacrifice. Like, okay, do we want the hotel or do we want to eat, or what's the word, like?
Hey.
What would we rather do?
Listen, at the end of the day, having like a good night's rest is pretty crucial, man. Like sleeping, getting well rested on the road is so hard, man. It really is a strenuous task to go out on the road. It's hard work, man. It's like you're not eating right, you're not sleeping right, you're not. You know, like your sensory overload. You're in a new place every day. You know, like it's
all that.
When you come back, I mean, I was just a wreck for a week, and when I come back off the road, man, you're just like, oh god, normal stuff. Like this is, oh,
Jesus. Normal stuff gets so fucking annoying, doesn't it? You're like, yo, I gotta go to the fucking grocery store. Like, oh, I have to do laundry right now. Like you start getting annoyed by that shit.
Oh yeah, it's all annoying. Yeah. Yeah, everything's tougher, but you know, it's a good time. It's a good time if you can bear through it. And you describe this to people, you know, and they're just like, "Well, then why do you want to do it?" I don't know. I don't know. Like, Dad didn't give me enough attention. I don't know.
I'm not sure why I want to do this shit.
Yeah.
I think it only hurts when, I mean, you'll notice the common thread between what we were just all talking about is that when you get home and you have to go back to quote unquote normal, I think the cure there is the same as not getting a hangover. You stay drunk. Well, instead of like, don't get the coming home hangover. Just stay on the road.
Just never
find a way to make it a fucking treadmill that never stops, and then you don't have to worry about
it. Oh my god. That sounds horrifying.
Are you kidding? To me, that sounds like heaven on earth, man.
Well, I mean, different strokes for different folks, I suppose. I was just watching this video of Michael Jackson passing out from exhaustion on stage.
Whoa.
And then I found out that I guess he hated going on the road, and I mean, at some point I could see that, like, cause I don't know, when I first started going on tours and stuff, I always was like, yeah, this is gonna be awesome. But after doing it for a few years, it's like, it starts to become kind of like a pain in the fucking ass, man, because it is very disruptive in my life, at least, you know, just to do that and, you know, come back, and I have a family, so they have to deal with me after I get back and shit. So I can see it. I can see how for some people it's just not the business, and then for some it's, you know, for like Syntac over here, it's fucking, you know, that's a dream.
Hell yeah.
You know, different strokes for different folks. I guess it wouldn't be so bad if it wasn't like you have to drive, and then just jump off the van and go right on the stage or something. If you're actually being driven, you know, if you're being driven in a bus and you're being flown to different places,
yeah, yeah,
That's a different thing. Your meals are all taken care of. You know, you just gotta show up and do your thing. Right. I feel like that'd be ideal.
That's ideal.
Right.
But the way that we gotta do it.
definitely not like that.
Well, yeah. It's fucking 12 hours on the road, 20 minute set, 20 minute nap, back on the road for 10 hours. Like, yeah, that is a bitch.
Let's go. It's a fucking party. Forever party. But man, those memories you get to make and the time that, especially if you get along with the people that you're on the road with, it's like, man.
Oh, yeah. It's important.
It's such a great experience of just bonding and just being with the homies and stuff. So I honestly want to go back on the road, but I just haven't had the right opportunity in so we'll see what's up. We'll see what the rest of this year brings. But so are you guys have any road gigs planned this summer? Like, what's going on with you guys?
Well, we just got back from the Europe thing, so we're gonna be, trying to
mode probably.
How long ago did you guys get back?
So I was back by like early March, I want to say.
Oh, maybe
mid March. He stayed for quite a while, like a couple months after. So
I got back like 3 days ago. So I'm still in that mode that we're talking about. I still got to go get like a half a gallon of some almond milk and shit. You
know? God damn it.
I got to go buy groceries. And like, I got to go do like civilian shit.
Barf. Why did you stay 2 extra months?
Cause we always stay scouting. Cause our objective is to be able to go back to the places that we went to at least. You know, like we'll pick sections of where, like, we're trying to feel certain places out. So like, we went out, we hit 3 cities out there. It was Copenhagen, Amsterdam, and Budapest.
Oh, sick.
And so like, he came along with us, like we went first to kind of like get the path going. Then by the time him and the photographer landed, we already had shit figured out. We could get from point A to point B this quickly instead of just trusting your Google Maps. You know what I mean? Like, wow. So by the time they landed, it was like a seamless 2 weeks. And then after they leave, we run back and retrack and try to solidify those contacts and try to like set up for the next tour so that the next time we come around, instead of 110 people at the show, maybe we could get 250, you know, so shit like that.
Oh, that's cool, man. How is Europe? Are they really receptive to hip hop?
Dude, they're loving it.
I would say they're more receptive to the type of hip hop that we make too, even more so than like your mainstream shit that you would hear in the States. It's kind of crazy. I didn't think it was really going to be that tough like that, but they're pretty about it in that aspect for the most part.
And quick to show love too. I mean, like Chief kept mentioning about how like just before people even heard who we were, just to know that there was some English speaking American hip hop from Las Vegas in town, that was enough to get people to react and at least look over and be like, oh shit, like they feel like there's already a piece of notoriety involved with that because you're so fucking far away from home. You don't even speak the language. Like, you must be somebody if you're out here this far away from home.
And I'm going to throw a shameless plug that Las Vegas is the greatest city on earth. And it's like world renowned. So I'm just going to throw that out there. Las Vegas.
I mean, it's definitely cool, man. There's definitely some cool people. That strip, though, is I cannot stand that fucking place.
The strip is only one piece.
I know. There's the old Vegas.
But you said the bunkhouse, so you already know.
You know about Vegas.
I do. Yeah. No. There's some cool places in Vegas. That's what people think when they think of Vegas is the strip, and it's like there's some cool people and there's some cool things going on out there. So it's not all just lights and fountains and shit.
Right.
There's some
cool shit. You spent a lot of time down in San Diego, right? So how was that scene in comparison? I mean, you were close enough to feel both scenes, right?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, I would say that, I mean, if you're comparing like hip hop scenes, I would say Vegas definitely took it a little bit more seriously, but sure. But like for San Diego, we got like there was the reggae is huge there. And jazz, there's a really healthy jazz community, but then you also got like, you know, like because Blink 182 comes from there, so you got like that pop punky type thing going on. So, well, mm-hmm. San Diego is a weird place to cut teeth musically, but I loved it. I missed the shit out of it. And the weather, obviously, the weather's amazing. But yeah, no, I would say if we're coming down to hip hop, I think Vegas has a little bit more grit. I feel like San Diego is such a distraction. Like just being the environment itself is such a distraction from, if you're not focused, you're lost in the fucking glitz and glamour, you know? So,
oh, for sure. That was
me for most of my time there. I was just day drinking and barbecuing, you know. Just
hey, bro, I've been doing that shit for like 25 years, living that same day.
Let's go, fucking day drinking, baby. So, like, have you guys ever had any problems with drugs or alcohol where you had to take a step back, or have you guys always been able to kind of keep it all under control?
I would say, I mean, I'm, you know, I've had my phases or whatever. I haven't really been like super drastically in need of help or anything like that. But yeah, you know, it gets bad, it gets good. There's times, there's not times. It's not detrimental though, yeah, on this end.
And if it ever does get to like to any level, In some circles, this is going to sound like a flex. And in other circles, this is going to sound like a disgusting fucking thing to say. But, like, I mean it with both ways in full sincerity. But, like, when the people that we rock with are, let's say, using by that kind of terminology, they're very functional users. In the sense where it at least is not becoming a problem to the point that it's like they can't function properly to do what they came to do type shit. You know, like if someone drinks, they drink, but they don't get so fucked up you got to drag them out somewhere. Or if someone smokes weed and, you know, out in the parking lot, yeah, they're going to smoke, they're going to show up, they're going to look high, they smell like weed. Yeah, it's obvious they went and smoked. But they're not going to pass out on the fucking stage. And you know what I mean? Like, so there's nothing that crazy, you know, we're not that wild with it.
Yeah. Nothing that gets in the way of the performance or the music, everything.
Right. Or to be able to do business. Cause we're businessmen as well. Like, not only are we in town to do the show, but like, I got to be up for a breakfast meeting with the freaking record store owner tomorrow morning, right after this after party. So I'm not going to get so wild that I show up and I look like a fucking trash can. You know what I'm saying? Like, because then how am I going to sell my records to your store when, like, you could smell me from around the corner?
Right, you know what I mean? Right. Did it take you a long time to figure out the business end of this as well?
It was one of those, like, survival things. It's like, I can't get a distributor to get me into this record store. Well, then what's the other way I can do it? I could stand out in front of the record store and try to convince people to buy my record instead of walking inside.
Yeah.
Or I go in and ask the people who work there, how can I get this record into this shelf and then promote that it's available here? You know, sometimes people help you with shortcuts. Sometimes there's like an official way and then there's the homie way. But when your record is right on the shelf next to some other legit record, the random person that walked into that store doesn't know whether or not it's because of your distribution deal or because your homie works there. So to them, it's all the same. Yeah. Our point is just to be able to be in the marketplace, be on the dance floor and fucking bust a couple moves, you know?
What was there ever like a period where you were, I mean, because I only speak out of experience, because like when I first started playing music, I was just like, I'm playing music, and you know, like it wasn't like negotiating money or anything like that. It was just,
right,
I'm playing. Like, was there ever a period where you were just sort of learning and trying to figure out how to make this work? And was it a struggle?
It still is right now.
Yeah, I get you. I get you. He's like, the struggle never stopped, bitch.
What do
you
think? No, it doesn't. Yeah. It's just the difference is you go from doing open mics for free to trying to negotiate that $50 bar tab and free parking.
Yeah.
And then someone else is negotiating their first $200 guarantee. Mm. And then the next step up, you know, someone is trying to get some out of town money to do a show for $300 at the local cafe.
Right.
And all the way up to people selling arena shows and making six figures for it.
Right.
I think it's like a test each level. It's like, okay, how much can we get here? How much can we push that button here? Yeah. Okay. Can we even push it even further here? Like, and so that's kind of been a learning thing too, as well.
And keep notes, you know, like certain venues will not let you get X, Y, Z. So stop asking. Well, you should know that in your notes. If this is your fourth or fifth time to that same venue, stop trying to push the button that you know doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this place will be willing to split the door with you, but that place won't. But this place will give you $100 guarantee, and this place won't give you shit. Mm-hmm. Or what, you know, so you remember what places gave you the best deals and what cities and shit.
Yeah, that's smart, man. Keeping a ledger of what's and what's going on, man. Whew, that's so much work. Like, I hated booking Joe. Who books gigs? Who's the one who books?
This fucking guy right here.
Man, I hated that. I hated that shit, man.
Hey, none of it's fun. That's why it's so indie. It hurts, bro. It's not so indie. I'm smiling. It's so indie. It's painfully indie. It does hurt.
Well, how much time do you put into actually booking gigs? Like, is it a daily thing for you? Is it just like what? How much time a week would you say goes into booking?
Just it's per campaign though. Like, I don't do things like on some like where I have like no 2 days are the same.
Mm.
You know, it's more like if we're doing a campaign for the next 2 weeks, I need to be just doing the shit that's like copyrights and getting masters and making sure everything is good to go. And then for the next 2 week chunk after that, now it's all about making sure that all the permits are in place, making sure the distribution deadlines are met, making sure these cities have been contacted. Then the, you know, like, so it comes in chunks. So like the booking, you're asking about booking, like that would be one of like the six steps in a campaign that I'd be running for like 2 or 3 months.
Hmm.
And out of that 2 or 3 months, I might put 3 weeks worth of booking into that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But that's just like one of the six other things, aspects that you got to pay attention to and that kind of shit. Places that have money can hire six different departments to do these things, but in our case, you got to split your workday up into six different chunks. You know?
So then, do you handle all of that stuff, Syntax, or do you delve out any of the work to any other people in the group?
He basically does.
I do most of it most of the time, but when it comes to real campaign time, I have people that I know. Like, I know I want to hire this photographer or this graphic designer, or I know, you know, whose phone I need to call for what region, if I need to know about, you know, extra venue help or that kind of shit. Like, am I doing the work? Yeah, I'm doing like the quarterbacking, but I'm hiring people when I can afford to hire them. And other times I'm hollering at people in the squad to,
I was going to say other times too, it's like, we each have like different contact, like lanes that we go to that like can benefit each other in that route, at least just to like make contact and just like, you know, then hit pitches or whatever it may be. But yeah, basically this guy right here, he's basically a star.
Nah.
Well, and it kind of goes back to what we were saying earlier. I mean, to do this kind of work, you it's more than just I write bars, you know, it's just bars on bars. It's like I write bars, I write emails, I receive emails. I have to
invoices, fucking everything.
I have to spend extra time in Europe to make more contacts. which sounds like a wonderful way to spend your time. It's like, fuck it, for a couple.
Oh, months. And it is. It's fun as hell. Yeah. But
how was that? How was Amsterdam? Did you guys smoke any weed in Amsterdam?
Hell yeah! Absolutely. What
was it good? Was it is it the good shit or what?
Yeah, nah, it was pretty great. I didn't have I wasn't too high of expectations because you know you hear Amsterdam, you think okay, maybe it's either 100% cool or 100% not cool.
Yeah,
and it was great. It was great. It was better than I thought. So.
That's the crazy thing to say, because with as much time as we're on the road, to say something was better than you thought or better than you expected is like you come to learn like that's a very, very fucking minuscule amount of the time. And we showed up to Amsterdam and it was like, holy shit, not only did it reach your expectations and be what you wanted it to be, but it was that and more. Yeah. Like we had a fucking blast in Amsterdam.
Definitely nice. Back then.
What? No, I mean, I don't want to get no one in trouble, but like, how are the hookers? How'd they look? How'd the prostitutes look? I heard they got a whole row of prostitutes. How was that going?
I would just say the day we went, it was pretty scary. It was pretty scary, my friend. It was frightening. It was a rainy day, so not a lot of things were happening. So it was even more so like,
steer clear.
I definitely would not be entering. What? Any of those establishments.
Well, I mean, it's interesting too to think that, you know, because in Vegas you guys got a whole community of hookers. So like it's interesting to go from one place to another. It's like, how was the comparison on Las Vegas whores compared to Amsterdam whores? Who
I never thought I would hear this question in my life.
Well, I need to know about these whores.
All right. It went when Chief, the day that Chief's talking about, and I remember that because that was on our way in.
Oh my God.
We went on a rainy day. It was like 12:15 in the, like,
yeah, it was
just afternoon. Like, people haven't even had lunch yet.
It wasn't even late.
So it was just a bad time to be able to answer that question properly. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. When I went back on our way back, like, later. Now it's not even winter anymore. Now it's spring. The weather's nicer. Mm. People are more festive. The girls in the window were looking real good.
All right.
Okay, so like it just so happens that when we did the lap with Chief, it was the end of winter. It was a bad time of day. So we did see some sketchy ass scenarios and some humans that you weren't really sure you wanted to be in a close proximity with.
Yeah.
But then when I went in the springtime, just like last week, there was a few that you wanted to kind of stop and look, but you don't want to stop for too long because then they buzz you in, and now you, next thing you know, you're negotiating for times and prices. Yeah. You know what I mean?
How much do the hookers go for in Amsterdam?
I wasn't even close enough to know that.
Okay. I can't even answer that question.
Yeah, no, fair enough. So what would you say then? Springtime hookers in Amsterdam or sunburnt hookers in Las Vegas? Which one? Right,
just because I know Las Vegas for my whole life, I would definitely go springtime.
Springtime in Amsterdam?
Yeah, somewhere else. Yeah.
Okay.
Pretty rough.
Got it. Well,
the sun is just the sun.
Yeah, well, you know, those sun-kissed prostitutes, they can be a little leathery.
Hey, shouts out to them. You know?
Yeah, hey, they make the world.
They out there working.
Hey, no shame. Ski.Reed, thank you so much for that follow. Thank you.
Ski.Reed, he's on the record, actually.
Believe it or not, that's one of the artists from our squad.
I don't believe it.
That is on the record. Yes.
Yeah, Ski.Reed, what the fuck? Why aren't you in this?
He can tell you all about the Tropicana Honeys.
Oh,
he knows a few things.
Black don't crack unless you're Cicely Tyson. How dare you? Cicely Tyson married Miles Davis, Samo. You better fucking watch your mouth. Ski.Reed, thank you so much for that follow and for being here. And I guess you're too busy to be in the conversation. So
we had a cardboard cutout of him, but we forgot it.
Yeah, we were supposed to stand him right here in the middle and be like, yeah, he's here. He just don't talk much.
get a weekend at Bernie's, me?
Exactly.
Well, thank God he didn't, because now we can see the record in the back there. So there we go.
There you go.
oh shit. So is this your first vinyl you guys are releasing, or have you guys released vinyl in the past?
This is number 8 for Keep Records.
Yeah, as far as for the label, for the collective overall, this will be the 8th title on vinyl.
Wow.
But for the So Indie, for the So Indie It Hurts series, mm-hmm. this is volume 3.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'm actually a hologram. The Tropicana hose. So wait, so did Skeeta, did he go to Amsterdam? Did they go to,
that has to be Reed who said that shit.
Did Skeeta go to Amsterdam too?
He did not, unfortunately.
Oh,
syntax.
Yeah.
Damn it, Skeeta, I needed to know if you thought the Tropicana hose trumped the Afghanistan. No, the shit. Amsterdam.
The Amsterdam springtime.
Yeah. I was in Florida. Okay, what about the prostitutes in Florida? Are they Vegas prostitutes or Florida prostitutes?
Skeeta. I don't know if I saw any Florida.
Which one?
No, but just by the type of people there, I might. Nah, I can't even pick.
I'm not talking about the ladies you find at the club or the ladies you find at the supermarket.
You're talking about the ones that are working.
The ladies of the night. The ladies of the street. We're not talking about. So I don't.
The only thing I could think about between difference of Florida and Vegas, like off top, is that Florida obviously has like thicker women. So that might be like the difference that I noticed. Anyone else, I don't know.
But the sun does hit both.
Yeah.
Equally heavily.
So there we go. Well,
both sunny.
Either way, Las Vegas or Florida, they're going to be better than the prostitutes we have here in Ohio. Let's go.
Oh shit. See, that's, I don't even know. I never been to Ohio, man.
That's to the
bone thugs. Naders, you did hear vinyl. These fine gentlemen here have a slew of vinyl that they got going on. Exclamation point. KR will bring up their Bandcamp. You can go to their Bandcamp and you can check out. I'm sure you can buy vinyl. You can buy vinyl from the Bandcamp, can't you?
Definitely, yeah. 100%.
Fucking get the fuck out of here. And you can even, here, we can actually go away. And we'll bring these guys back. Hold on. Come on, bitch. There we are. There they are. And here's is actually where they're at. So Naders, if you are interested, they do have vinyl, and the new song is called Great Weather, and this is the lead single off of the So Indie It Hurts Volume 3.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
Should we listen to that song?
Hey, by all means, go ahead. If that's part of the show, if that's something you do, let's rock it, man.
Let's fucking go. Nader, you can check out this. Check it out. See what you feel. Will you guys mute your end so we can get a clean?
Yeah, for sure, man.
All right, we're gonna listen to the lead single off of So Indie It Hurts Volume 3. It's called Great Weather, and it features Trade, Voorhees, Syntax, Vernac, Wave, MMLZ, and Chief DVB. Everyone, let's fucking get into this shit. Let's go. Oh, wait, hold on. Let me turn this down a bit. All right, let's go.
Yeah. Now, fuck sitting down. Let's get it. Hey, yo. The world is so vast, no more sitting in Vegas, I'm past waiting for my chance, yo, I'ma get it fast, fuck sitting in last, I wanna surf on my fans, just like my brother Chief, I don't wanna be in the stands, I wanna live it up, it's music shit, I never give it up, it's in my blood, road less traveled, I know the mission's tough, smile on my face, but it's the biggest bluff. Came a long way from dead end jobs, had the pits and cups. Now we engineering the city to stack the biggest bucks. I'm just trying to get it and I can't get enough. Yeah, for real. I'm just trying to get it and I can't get enough. I prefer to work with those that are close to me. Seen trade having back-to-back frozen treats. Talking about the shit too cold. If I could be so bold. You killed it tonight, my man, but let's roll. No time to celebrate, we got another show. Time slips through our grips, but how much left, yo, we never know. That's why we stay putting in work and watch it grow. By the time you're tuning in, we on the next episode. Dynamic, in the captain, down with it, Titanic. Flaws of the mismanaging the stone granite. Not a bedrock, feel lavish. Solo's gone Lenny Kravitz, and it look pretty tragic. 2 a.m. in the Denny's blasting. Stretching funds like it's made elastic. I'm a Trey, we taxing. In Orlando like we played the Magic. With the Wizard, motorcade and traffic. Parade the trophy on the floor, we laughing. Casual, how I'm acting like it never happened. Paid the sass in the label contract. Did the max to relax. Never had to act erratic. The ghost high, I float in transit. Crash Bandicoot the coupe like Andy Gavin. I'm still traveling in shoes that I can't imagine. Tie me up in your finest fashion. Get that tire and hit them banks. Cashing checks and you ain't have to ask them. They just send it. Words create intentions. I'm always in the seven. Gamble pennies for my pleasure. I'm like 50 shades of gray heather. And I'm sunning motherfuckers like great weather. Sun.
Let's go. Oh man, I'm sunning motherfuckers like great weather. There you go.
Hey, you said you knew, you said you wanted bars.
That bars on bars. Yeah, man. This is Ski Dot wants to know when we're gonna play a song with him on it.
Oh shit. Hey, if I could recommend it, I would, because Ski Dot is one of the best rappers in the world.
All right, so, where's Ski Dot? Where's the one with Ski Dot on it?
Yeah, well, that's he's not
on,
dropping.
Yeah, he's on the record, and that you're gonna have to see him on that shit on the May 20th.
Dang. Okay. Well, there you go, Ski Dot. Then until May 20th, everybody, make sure you mark it off in your calendar. And again, I'm dropping the links in the show notes here, so if you guys want to check out. Ski Dot is just chatting. Wait, is it Ski Dot? Do you bingo bongo? How is that not allowed? I fucking hate Twitch sometimes. Ski Dot, do you actually stream? Are you actually on here streaming?
I think he's a streamer.
Is Ski Dot?
Been a while, I think, but I think he's a streamer.
Let's go, Ski Dot. Watch out.
That's G Reed.
Yeah, let's go. Okay, there he is.
That's him.
He's out here. He's out here. I used to be heavy. I'd be living off of in the mountains, bro. That's all cool. But hey, you do you, baby boo. You do you. Okay, so let's get back to this. Let me get back over here. Wow, we're back, baby. We're back. Who does a lot of the production for you guys? Do you guys have a lot in-house production? Do you guys buy your beats off of Fiverr? Like, what, how does that work for you guys?
So basically my main producer and producer that does a lot of shit with us is Wave Mammals, and he's like also rapper extraordinaire. He is great, and he makes fire beats, and he's the best. And then also we have Trade Voorhees that's on this project as well, and Trade is also a rap producer extraordinaire from Las Vegas.
So
we try to keep it mostly in-house on that end of things.
Wait, Ski Dot says that, so he is also a producer.
Ski Dot Reed is also a fire producer, rapper extraordinaire.
Very much so, but only for the sake of not heralding that particular fact was because he didn't produce on this record.
Yeah.
G Reed was as an MC. That was his artist role here. Not to say that he can't do many other things very well at a very high artistic level, but on this particular record, we had him involved on the MC point.
Yeah, this was mostly Wave Trade production. on this.
Gotcha. So, that's great. You guys have that in-house production going on. You got to appreciate that. You don't have to always constantly go out and be looking for shit. Right. I came with straight lyrics, like a swordsman cutting meat. Let's go. Let's go, Ski Dot. Let's go. So then you guys, just getting back from Europe, you guys don't have any plans on any sort of tours or anything for the rest of the year?
I wouldn't go that far.
There's some things, but
yeah, we'll be leaving the state and we'll be doing that kind of thing. But as far as more international, no. But but yeah, we will still be touring for during this calendar year. That will still be happening for sure.
Where do you guys? So where's the spot to play now in Vegas for the underground hip hop?
Fuck man, it's hard. Las Vegas is a weird city for that shit. I would say it's always changing. One spot in particular that's fire right now. A couple spots. The Usual Space has been pretty lenient on things. Taverna Costerna is pretty cool. As far as venue wise,
The Sand Dollar lately.
The Sand Dollar too. Yeah,
which is cool because it's at the Plaza Hotel, like downtown on Fremont.
Okay.
So it's like you can kind of use the point of, well, it's still within reach to touristy types, but it's not so far out of reach that locals won't still fuck with it.
Right.
Yeah, 100%. Those are probably like the main ones I would think that I can think of off top, at least.
I mean, I feel like the Bunkhouse Saloon, that was like a special place for Vegas. I don't know. Like, did you guys feel that too? Do you think that was it just seemed like a really, really unique spot, man. And it's a shame that it had to go. What did you guys end up doing during the pandemic? What was your guys's thing? Were you guys kind of?
Hello, Mighty.
Oh,
this
shit.
Is Jean-Claude Van Damme. And I want to give you a huge thank you, a big old split.
Sorry,
and
Jean-Claude is talking.
As a thank you for all that you do for this channel.
The Bunkhouse is cool. The Bunkhouse was definitely cool. That spot was definitely, the thing about Las Vegas is like, they're not so hyped about rap shows and hip hop shows in general. Like a lot of venues try to like not host those types of events. But the Bunkhouse was cool because it had a lot of like indie bands and stuff. Not to say it wasn't a hip hop venue, but there wasn't too much hip hop compared to other things that were going on there. Yeah. But, you know, during the pandemic, everyone kind of like ran out of shows and ran out of venues because things weren't happening. So a lot of people like either they gave up or they converted to Twitch or like some type of live streaming shows or like, you know, small intimate things that a lot of people weren't pulling up to, but people could still pull up to.
Right.
So that was kind of a sketchy area there, but I feel like we're back in full mode on that end.
Right.
A lot of Las Vegas artists are back and that's just flourishing again, instead of everyone being like, yo, what the fuck are we gonna do?
Yeah, the only difference is now, instead of it being an artist pool of 60 different artists going for it, now it's more like a pool of like 45.
Yeah. Huh.
You know, it's almost like the pandemic shows you, like, it shows you whether or not you care enough to continue doing some shit when it's no longer getting the response you thought you wanted for it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So the people who were artists because they really love making art continued to do that. And the ones that needed a reaction kind of realized that maybe they were doing it for the wrong reason and it wasn't worth it for them anymore to continue. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure. It's interesting how that can happen, huh? This is like all of a sudden, I don't really play music right now either. I'm just doing my podcast and I play music with my wife every once in a while. But it's interesting how the pandemic really took some folks out of the equation, which can't be the worst thing. Not for, you know, I mean, because this is such a competitive, I was going to say competitive sport, which it is kind of a competitive sport.
basically almost is.
But yeah, it's definitely a fucking sport of endurance. Oh my god. But yeah, I've known a lot of folks out of Vegas. Jessica Manalo is one. And god damn it, I can't remember the girl who played. There was a few people. I can't remember any of their names anymore. Anyways, doesn't matter. we're here, we're now. Okay, so then what is your guys' plans then for Jesus Christ, what are you guys' plans on pushing this new album?
I mean, you know, we're going to try to get it everywhere we can, every outlet. The people that we have on it are really, like, heavy hitters. So that also plays a part of, like, yo, this is really, like, I don't know, culturally impactful for the city, in my opinion, with the linkage. So we're going to try to just keep pushing that, you know, try to do some shows, radio shows, podcasts, all this type of things that we can to just try to get it to the world, really.
Yeah, trying to splash more, like making it be for Vegas for basically the first little bit. Let them have, like, we're doing the early listening party 3 days before the drop date, just so they can have 3 days to kind of like celebrate it the local way, you know what I mean? And then come the 20th, once it's available to everyone else, most of our Vegas people and most of the people that, you know, give heavy support locally will already have it, and they could kind of celebrate with us. Like, it's like if you're from Manchester City and Man City wins a soccer game, the whole city goes and celebrates type shit. Like, there's enough people from within the hip hop community here in Vegas that are happy to see these artists together on one record. And we want them to be able to celebrate that a little bit before it's like available now type shit, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's sick. That's real cool, man. That's cool that you guys have this, you know, this idea of bringing community together. And you know, it's interesting how you guys are saying that Las Vegas didn't really like, a lot of venues aren't really keen on having hip hop. Is it because they view it as like they associate it with violence?
I mean, you know, like anytime people say hip hop or rap, there's already this connotation of like, oh, okay, whatever the fuck, insert here, whatever they think about it.
Some kind of stigma or some like, you know, like animosity. I mean,
the violence thing is kind of a thing too. Like people think that it's, you know, this whole other thing than it is. And it's really not like that. It's just, you know, of course there's going to be certain factors of like, okay, one out of every 100 hip hop artists are going to be like gangster rap. You know what I'm saying? So of course you're going to get like someone talking about that shit or whatever it may be. But I think, they don't host as much love towards that genre in our city. And it's unfortunate, but we're trying to change that. So
for sure. For sure.
I'm sorry. You know, like the whole like gangster rap thing, it's one of those like a lot of these talent buyers and booking agents on the local level, unless someone's a hip hop head, it's hard for them to really understand when you say hip hop, like it could be one of like 7 or 8 subgenres that don't even relate to one another. So if I say hip hop to some, you know, 57-year-old Karen who's been sick of booking local bands for the last 10 years at the local joint, she's going to remember that one time in 1999 when she booked this freaking local gangster rapper
who smoked
too much weed in the bathroom and stabbed some kid with a 2-inch fucking Swiss Army knife. Like, she's going to remember that as her picture of hip hop in her head. So anytime you want to say you want to book hip hop, she's going to say no. Even though you might be just a couple backpacking nerds that show up in a group of 60 and politely pay for your drinks at the bar and even and tip 26% to the bartenders and everyone leaves happy. Yeah. But they never gave you that chance because that dude with the Swiss Army life in 1999 fucked up her image of hip hop. Yeah, you know what I mean?
G Reed says, damn, she remembers me.
Yeah.
Well, also too, like
it
also
was Skeeter.
Las Vegas is like the entertainment capital of the world, so we got to remember that. Like, we're competing with like residential strip acts. Hmm. You know what I'm saying? So like,
fucking Carrot Top
is not going to produce as much money as fucking Lady Gaga every night or whatever it may be. So it's like,
or who wants to see Keep Records at the local dive bar when they can watch Boys to Men for $23 at the fucking garage? You know what I'm saying?
So damn, you can see it for $23.
That's a hard thing to navigate as well. So that's kind of for underground.
But it's Boys to Men though.
I'm exactly.
I'm bending knee, baby. Come on, let's go.
Why are you gay?
Dave, and do it a cappella.
Guys, I appreciate y'all coming on the show today. As we wrap up here, I do want to make sure everybody knows that the new album that which is coming out on May 20th, So Indie It Hurts, Volume 3. You can get it on vinyl. Go ahead, get that shit. Moving Dutchman, good to see you, my friend. You're right on time. Thank you, Ski.Reed, for dropping those links. Those are the links for Keep Records. Go and click on there. Go listen to music. Follow them on their socials and on their YouTubes. It's a good time. Gentlemen, I would like to ask you one final question. Doesn't matter who goes first. What's the best piece of advice that you've ever gotten?
Don't waste time doing the shit that you don't enjoy.
Damn. That was good. That was real quick, too.
And you know what? I don't even really remember who it was or the context, but it fit in so many different slots that I was like, that's my one. That's my shit.
Yeah, for sure. Easy to say. Shut up, Moving Dutchman.
All right, I got two. I can't narrow it down to one. That's fine. Only because they're hella important. But also before those, shout out to you for having us on here. And we really appreciate
no worries.
This whole shit.
Yeah, no worries, man.
So number one, enjoy the journey because the destination might not ever fucking show up. Hmm. That's one huge thing. Like, none of that shit that you think might happen will happen. But if in this present, it's happening right now, so make sure to stay there. And the second thing is to save the roach.
That's important.
That is...
That's heavy.
Save the roach. Bro... Yeah, let me just say so. I remember when I lived in Cali, I had a backyard full of weed. And I remember after harvest, I would just be like smoking blunts and just flicking the roaches and shit. Like, I don't even care. And you know, a few months go by and you smoke your supply. And then you're just like, you think of those roaches that you're just like, psh. Whatever, flicking over here. You're just
right
like,
over the fence.
God damn it!
When you really need it, you know what I'm saying? It's like when you really need it.
You're at the dispensary paying way too much for weed. Like, you dirty bitch, you fucked yourself. Exactly.
You flicked a half ounce over these last months over this damn backyard wall.
You thought you were so fucking tight. Because you had so much. You had pounds and now you have nothing. Yeah. Oh my god. Hey, Syntax Chief.
Hello, Moving Dutchman.
Okay. This we're waiting for Moving Gandalf. Dutchman first. Hold on.
Thank you for all that you do for this channel.
Thank you, Mighty
always
Mighty.
Always remember, a Moving Dutchman is never late, nor early, but arrives precisely. What he means to.
Thank you, Raina, for that Moving Dutchman. And thank you, Mighty Mighty, for the gifted sub to Naders. Thank you so much. And thank you, Syntax Chief. I appreciate y'all. Everybody, make sure you go check out their links. If you're listening
Hello,
to this.
Hello, Mighty Mighty. This is Jean-Claude.
Can I fucking. Can I say goodbye to my guests?
A big old splits. And the
stop fucking triggering shit, you fucking animals.
We're trying to raise your stock. You're gonna be on the public stock exchange soon after this shit.
Ski Dot, thank you so much. Mighty Mighty, thank you for gift subbing Ski Dot. I'm out here just trying to say goodbye to my guests, and y'all are fucking with me right now. I appreciate y'all. Again, thank you guys so much. If you guys make sure you're clicking the links. If you're listening to this on the audio side, make sure you're clicking the links in the show notes. I appreciate y'all. Everybody, please give a nice warm applause to our guests today, Syntax Vernac and Chief DVB of Keeping Records. Let's go! Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Have a good day, guys.